For years, director Denis Villeneuve has presented beautiful and thought-provoking films that address the complexities of human morality, and his 2015 film Sicario is no different. While on its surface Sicario can be seen as a tense action thriller focusing on the deadly war between the drug cartel and American law enforcement, the film favors a somnambulistic and pensive pace, broken up by instances of explosive violence and gripping suspense, exploring thematic elements through its use of colors, environments, and boundaries. Sicario invokes the idea that the conceptual dividers that we use to categorize and classify the world, particularly in regard to notions of morality, of good and evil, that these boundaries are not only fragile and fluid, they may be ultimately meaningless. It uses the visual tools of color, light, transparency, and translucency to explore the relationships between concepts of good and evil, destabilizing their paradigms, calling into question their fallacies and illusions, to remind us that the realities of the world are so very infrequently simple issues of black and white. The most readily apparent visual metaphor the film presents is the interplay between light and dark. What's immediately striking about Sicario from a visual standpoint is the prevalence of the neutral color beige. From the expansive desert seen in the opening shot, to the walls of the cartel compound, to hallways, boardrooms, bathrooms, and cars, the film is saturated with beige tones.
I guess we're not following any procedures.
Concerning concepts of morality, the beige palette alludes to the ambiguous nature of right and wrong. Emily Blunt's character Kate Macer is introduced in the darkness of a police van, lit by thin beams of white light. She can thus be seen as the light amidst the dark, a force of perceived good penetrating the evil of a corrupt and lawless world. As an explosion kills several of her fellow officers, Kate is introduced to a scenario of moral ambiguity, where her convictions will be cast into doubt. She encounters mysterious characters in Josh Brolin's Matt Graver and Benicio del Toro's Alejandro, both of whom are presented as enigmatic figures, and are both subsequently clad in beige as she embarks with them on an unknown mission. Alejandro in particular seems to captivate her, as his refusal to reveal his associations makes him an object of intrigue and fascination. Kate's adherence to and belief in the law and to the ideals of social justice are represented by the color blue, seen in her and her partner's wardrobe, and mimicked by Matt and Alejandro while they're in police institutions and under their supervision, as they play the part of law-abiding officers. However, once they return to their natural environment, the margins between lawfulness and lawlessness, they are seen again wearing beige. They are clearly at home in this world of ambiguity, while Kate, quite evidently, is not. Her idealism is represented through visual metaphors of light and dark. When she defies authority to impose justice by the book, we see her through a black and white camera. Like a moth to the flame, she is persistent in her quest to enforce her ideals of good and evil, and to impose systematic justice. But as the film progresses, her idealism is proven to be naive. Not a virtue, but a crushing weakness. Her loss of faith in the effectivity of social justice is shown visually through the gradual desaturation of her blue shirt, which changes to a pale blue, to gray, and eventually a nihilistic white. If she is the light in the darkness, that light is swallowed by an ocean of violence and despair, drowned by the sheer scope and pervasiveness of moral uncertainty. Benicio del Toro's Alejandro becomes a physical representation of this darkness, seen clad in black clothing and sitting in shadow. In their final encounter, Kate finds herself utterly inadequate, unwilling to sacrifice everything for her beliefs, and thus proving her powerlessness to effect any meaningful change. But Sicario's deconstruction of morality goes beyond simple color coding, as it uses varying levels of opacity and transparency to allude to the fallacious nature of moral classification. Initially, the barriers that separate good from evil are obvious, thick walls hiding devious secrets, obscuring evil behind visual shields. But later we see walls that are transparent, yet still obscuring.
A clearer picture on who the victims.
As Kate and her partner are withheld details of a potential operation by soundproof glass. Despite the supposed transparency of the system of justice, the truth is still hidden, and the moral intent of those in power unknowable, but only to themselves. As the film progresses, we see visual barriers and dividers obscured by dust particles or by drapes, and windows by sunlit reflections. The film tells us explicitly and through its visual language that basic and simplistic tenets of right and wrong only function on a micro scale.
She moved to a small town where the rule of law still exists.
The proposition, for instance, that evil hides behind thick walls is dispelled when we are finally shown the man who apparently represents the utmost evil, who we find eating dinner outdoors, hidden notably by no walls at all. The most elusive figure in the drug trade is presented ironically as the most visually exposed and vulnerable. If he is the monster he is supposed to be, we see him now as almost a victim. The film shows us that Kate's notions of justice and morality are based largely on perceptions and on labels.
For the DEA? You're not American.
No.
Who do you work for now? It's full of cowboys.
I'm a cowboy.
You're a redneck.
I'm a redneck. I got a trailer. I got a wife.
What are you talking about?
I got a trailer. I got a wife. She's my sister.
I just tried to have sex with my hitman.
He's no assassin.
Keep an eye out for the state police. They're not always the good guys.
Alejandro works for the fucking Colombian cartel.
The moral paradigms she draws between crime and lawfulness, which allow her to rationalize her involvement in this fight, are shown to be facile, shifting, blurring lines that gradually give way to anarchy. The character Alejandro, again serving as an embodiment of this deconstruction of moral classifiers, loses his title as characters begin to refer to him not as Alejandro but as Medellin. After hearing characters reference a prominent figure in the Mexican cartel, for instance, we might be led to assume that the man we see in the following scene is a criminal or drug dealer, until we are shown he's a policeman. As the film repeatedly cuts back to Silvio and his family, we are led to assume that his role in the story might be significant, that he will play some greater part in the events to come. But ultimately, he's shot dead in the street, his role no more impactful than any of the other countless henchmen or criminals dispatched in the Bloody Crusade, leading us to ask ourselves as viewers whether his death is more tragic than any of the others, because we know and see that he has a family. Sicario suggests that there are no easy answers to these questions, and perhaps no definite answers at all. The final scene of the film visually summarizes this notion succinctly. We see children, still innocent of the grim realities of their existence, playing a game in which there are two clear sides, rules, justice, and order. The distant gunfire threatens to tear this state of innocence apart, awakening man to the reality of his true nature, in which good and evil lose all semblance of meaning. Sicario shows us that such simplicity is exclusive to the domain of children, that morality cannot be constrained to distinctions of black and white, but rather a desert of beige, composed of countless shifting fragments that will slip ever from our grasp.